Hey guys, what's up? It's John from flymycalf.com, and today we're going to be talking about a really interesting topic. A lot of people have questions about this one. It's what's the difference between a high-wing aircraft and a low-wing aircraft? So how does moving the wing like 3 feet lower to the ground really change how the aircraft flies? And you might be kind of interested to hear what the answer really is, because a lot of people think that just by moving the wing down makes a huge difference. It kind of does and kind of doesn't. So we're going to walk you through all the characteristics of how that really affects how the airplane flies. We'll look at a couple different airplanes like Moonies, Cherokees, Cirruses, Cessna 172s, and kind of walk you through each one, the different characteristics of how they fly, and the different characteristics of how the wings are built. And that's what really affects how these airplanes fly, more so than just the location of the wing, on the actual aircraft structure. Okay, so the first thing I want you to notice as we walk up to this regular old 172 is how flat the wing is, basically. How little dihedral there is in the wing. It's relatively even all the way across. It's not tilted up or tilted down. Next thing, as we walk around the side here, take a look at the width of the wing relative to the length of the wing. So basically the aspect ratio of the wing. Is it really long and skinny, or is it really short and fat? And then we're going to go ahead and walk into the wing root here and look out down the wing, and notice how the wing root is angled up more than the wing tip. So the wing tip is tilted down a little bit with a lower angle of attack, lower angle of incidence, and the wing root has a higher angle of incidence, so it's a higher angle of attack as the aircraft's flying along. So those things all coupled together really determine the differences in how the aircraft's going to fly. Camber, dihedral, ratio, and the angle of attack are our main things that we're going to be talking about today. So hopefully you know the definitions of those four terms, but if you don't, we'll do a quick review here. So first thing, dihedral. We've got a nice flat wing here in our Cessna 172, and if this wing happened to be tilted up a little bit more, we would say it had a lot of dihedral. And what the dihedral does is ultimately when the aircraft's in a bank, it's going to make it want to right itself and go back to wings level. We have all that vertical lift trying to tilt the aircraft back, and this horizontal lift contributing to the turning of the aircraft. But as the aircraft skids to the side, it wants to level itself out just because the air is pushing down on the high wing and not so much on the lower wing. So that dihedral contributes to stability in making the aircraft want to be wings level. So when people think that, oh, it's a high wing, therefore it's more stable because there's all that weight underneath it, well, it just doesn't need as much dihedral. Compared to a low-wing aircraft, oh, it's top-heavy, it's going to tip over. No, simply by adding dihedral to the wings, we can add a lot of stability and make the aircraft fly straight and level just the same as a high-wing aircraft with all that weight slung underneath the wing. Now, our next two key terms, camber and ratio. Camber is really how thick the wing is, and thicker wings tend to develop more lift at slower speeds, but also generate more drag, so they're better for slower aircraft. Thinner wings develop less lift at low speed, but they still develop lots of lift at high speed, so they're better for faster aircraft. So you can still get lots of lift out of a thin wing, just have to go a lot faster to do so. Now, in terms of ratio, ratio is really going to be the width compared to the length of the wing. So when we have like a glider with really long, thin wings, that can fly at very high angles of attack and have a very low stall speed. Shorter wings are good because there's less drag, because there's just pure less wing out there, but they need much faster airspeeds to develop much lift and get above their stall speed. You'll typically find short wings will really sink at low speeds like a rock, and long, thin wings will tend to float a long ways, float down the runway just like a glider might, where it can just float in ground effect forever. Now, angle of attack we've covered before in previous videos, but remember it's the angle between the chord line and the relative wind, so the angle at which the wing is meeting the air around it. Not the pitch angle of the aircraft, but the pitch angle that the air is actually meeting the wing at as it's flying through the air, so the difference between the chord line and the relative wind. So now let's go ahead and take a look at a low-wing airplane. So we're going to walk over to this Piper Cherokee over here and take a look at how that wing is shaped different than our 172. So the first thing to notice as we walk up here is how wide this wing is. And it's not tapered at all. It's very short and very wide. It's very deep. It's about probably 4 feet deep and only a 30-foot wingspan compared to the 172 of about a 36-foot wingspan. Also, we've got a very thick wing all the way out to the tip, so the camber is the same from the wing root to the wing tip compared to the 172, where it tapers off and the camber gets a little thinner towards the tip. As we walk out to the front here, you'll notice there's a lot of dihedral in the wing. The wings are tilted up much more compared to the 172, where it has a much flatter wing. So the dihedral is contributing to the stability. It's going to require more aileron use in a crosswind compared to a 172. And it has this Hershey bar wing. This other Piper Challenger here to the right also has that same Hershey bar wing, where it maintains that camber all the way out to the tips. So the tip is trying to generate just as much lift as the wing root, and it's not going to stall first. There's certain devices on here to prevent that. A, it's a short wing, so there's a lot of washout, basically high pressure air coming from the bottom of the wing to the top to lower the angle of attack on the wing tip. There's a wing fence on this airplane that helps stop lateral flow or spanwise flow. And that ensures that you have good aileron control all the way through a stall, or as you approach a stall, rather than having to make changes like twisting the wing like they do on the 172. We can look at this low wing airplane, a Cirrus here, and you'll notice there's still dihedral there for stability, but a little less so because they're less concerned with stability on this airplane compared to speed. They want a little bit more speed, so they have less dihedral there. It's a tapered wing, so they have a nice thin wing tip out there, so it's designed to go a little faster. And to ensure that you have aileron control through a stall or as you approach a stall, they go ahead and they actually almost cut this wing into two, and they have the wing tip at a much lower angle of incidence, so a lower angle of attack as you're flying along, than the wing root. And you'll also notice these little silver triangle-shaped pieces of metal on the leading edge of the wing root, and that actually will induce a stall at a lower angle of attack, so it'll force the wing root to stall at a lower angle of attack. So you'll get a buffet, and you'll feel it in the controls, and it'll also create a nose down pitching moment at the wing root before the tip stalls. So the idea is, as the airplane approaches a stall, you'll still have aileron control. You won't be likely to go into a spin, but the nose will drop down, and you'll get the shaking in the airframe to let you know, hey, let the controls forward and let the nose drop to recover and lower the angle of attack. So let's just go ahead and talk about these different wing shapes for a moment here between our Cirrus and our Cherokee. So the Cherokee's got these short, fat wings, that aspect ratio, that the idea is it's good for when you're cruising at high speed, but it's not going to want to fly at a super high angle of attack. Thus, you're going to need a little bit more airspeed to get the thing flying. Now, the other caveat here is it's a Hershey bar wing, the same camber from the wing root all the way out to the wing tip. That means we're calling for the same amount of lift proportionally from the wing root as the wing tip. So as we're flying along at 1,000 feet, we have high pressure air coming from the bottom of the wing onto the top of the wing, causing wingtip vortices, and we effectively lose the last little bit of our wingtip. Let's just say we lose a foot of that wing. Well, it's a short wing. It's only a 30-foot wingspan. So when we lose that last foot of the wing, proportionally, we're losing more lift, leaving ground effect, and flying, you know, at 20, 30, 50, 1,000 feet on a Cherokee than the amount of lift we lose in leaving ground effect on something like a Cirrus with longer wings and a tapered wing, so we're calling for less lift at the wingtip. So when we leave ground effect in the Cirrus and we have that high pressure air start to seek the low pressure on the top and effectively cut off that last little bit of our wingtip, we're not losing as much lift. So there's not going to be as much of a noticeable difference on a Cirrus leaving ground effect as there is on a Cherokee. Cherokees can carry a lot of weight and can take off and fly in ground effect, but a lot of people have put four people on these little Cherokees that just can't really handle it and get out of ground effect, lose that last foot of the wing, so to speak, and have to pitch up to maintain more lift from the rest of the wing, increasing the angle of attack, increasing drag, and then they start to slow down, settle, and they wind up hitting the trees at the end of the runway because they were able to get up flying in ground effect, but as soon as they left ground effect, the airplane simply couldn't provide enough lift because of that shorter wing. So is one better than the other? Not really. It's just important to realize that if you're coming into land, say like in a Cherokee, and you chop power and flare at 20 feet, it's going to bleed off speed pretty quickly and drop like a rock, compared to if you fly that same Cherokee down to a foot or two and chop power and flare, well, it's going to float and flare much more like a normal airplane, much more like a Cirrus or a 172 would, because the Cirrus and 172 have that tapered wing where they're not calling for as much lift from the wing tip. So the difference in the gain and loss of lift entering or leaving ground effect just isn't quite as noticeable as it is with something like a Piper Cherokee. So what's a little takeaway here? Well, if you happen to be flying a Cherokee or a short-winged airplane at gross weight, maybe before you leave ground effect, make sure you pick up an extra few knots and accelerate the airplane to VY before you climb out and leave ground effect, so you know you're on the front side of the power curve rather than getting on the back side where you're going to induce a lot of drag leaving ground effect. Other things to look at here in our Cirrus is we have these fancy leading edge devices. The idea is they're going to keep us more safe by having a lower angle of incidence with that split wing at our wing tip, giving the aileron authority throughout, you know, the approach to stall. Obviously, if you stall the entire wing, you lose aileron authority. But the idea is that the wing root could stall without the wing tip stalling, and the pilot would still have aileron authority to keep the wings level and hopefully not roll into a spin, although these airplanes do have a tendency to wind up in spins. Conveniently enough, they have a parachute mounted to them, so hopefully that can help you out. There's also these little fancy leading edge devices here, those little silver triangle shaped things on the leading edge of the wing root, and the idea behind these are to actually induce a stall. They actually cause flow separation at a lower angle of attack from the top of the wing to create buffeting sooner, so that the pilot will hopefully realize, oh man, I can feel buffeting through the control stick and through the airframe, I'm about to stall and recover, but throughout that whole time period, hopefully he still has aileron authority. It also can cause a loss of lift from the wing root, which would hopefully cause a nose down pitching moment, lowering the angle of attack on the airplane, continuing to give you aileron authority with the low angle of attack out the wing tips, and hopefully recovering from the stall, or helping you to recover from the stall by allowing the nose to drop down on its own. So that's the idea with those little triangles on the leading edge of the wing. They don't decrease your stall speed. It's not like a stall kit. It's actually increasing the stall speed or lowering the angle of attack at which the aircraft will stall, or that part of the wing will stall, as a safety measure. Now lastly, the Cirrus has less dihedral. Why do they choose this? You know, if it's less stable, why not bend those wings way up? Well, obviously when you bend the wings up, you start to develop horizontal lift, even when you're in flight and it's opposing each other. So you're developing lift that's not really contributing to anything when that lift is just being vectored off the sides and not contributing to lifting the airplane up. So it causes more drag, because if you need more lift to keep the airplane in the air, then you have more drag on the overall airframe. So a flatter wing is going to be less drag, but you need some dihedral in a low-wing airplane just for stability's sake. So Cherokee, being a trainer, they put lots of dihedral in to make it very stable. In a Cirrus, a little bit more high-performance airplane, they put less dihedral in because they're looking for some more performance out of the airframe. Now that we've looked over a few different types of airplanes and covered the characteristics of what makes them fly the way they do, really based on the wing, more than it being a high-wing or a low-wing airplane, let's take a look at a few more airplanes and make some assumptions about the way they're going to fly. So we have a Mooney with a little bit of dihedral in there for stability. It's a tapered wing, so thicker wing root than wing tip, so we have more lift coming from the wing root than from the tip. It's not very twisted. There is a slight bit of twist in there to give you a lower angle of attack or lower angle of incidence at the wing tip to help throughout the approach to a stall. We also have a leading edge device there on the wing root that's going to help the wing root stall first and give you that buffet and loss of lift to help the nose pitch down and recover from a stall sooner. So you're going to maintain aileron authority throughout the stall. As we come over here to a high wing airplane, we have another 172 to look at. And same characteristics. We have that angle of incidence where the wing tip is tilted down and the wing root is tilted more up to give you more lift at the wing root. Also a higher angle of attack and a stall that's going to happen sooner. There's much less dihedral because they're really relying on the weight of the cockpit and the weight of the fuselage to provide much of that stability to the airplane. So less dihedral there. And you also have the tapered wing, so you're going to have a little less pronounced difference between being in ground effect and out of ground effect. Back over to another Cherokee, we have that Hershey bar wing with the camber, the same all the way throughout. There's no taper, so there's going to be a pretty pronounced difference between being in ground effect and out of ground effect. It's a shorter wing, a 30-foot wingspan compared to some of those longer, thinner wings. So it's going to definitely want a higher speed to get up out of ground effect and maintain a good climb rate. It's going to have a tendency to plow and drop at a steep angle at lower speeds. And although this one's a little crooked, you can kind of see the dihedral there. There's definitely more dihedral in that Cherokee since it's a trainer and they're looking for stability. And it happens to have one strut there that's a little low on the right side. Coming over here to our diamond, it has wings. They're much more like that of a glider. That's going to give you good performance at high angles of attack. It's going to allow the airplane to float in ground effect. It's going to take off out of ground effect very easily. And it's going to be able to maneuver at lower speeds and higher angles of attack, so it's going to have a slightly lower stall speed. Now, it's also a tapered wing with that little winglet there, so that should help with aileron authority throughout a stall. And we can really notice here that aspect ratio. Very long wings, not very wide, so it really performs well at higher angles of attack. And if you come in fast in this thing and get into ground effect, you can expect it to float for a very, very long time because there's very low drag on that shape of a wing when you're just floating along in ground effect. It also has those leading edge devices that help produce a stall sooner. So that's really selecting how far down spanwise they want that wing to stall at. And also one other important thing to notice here is we have a T-tail on the airplane. So we didn't talk much about that, but obviously with your horizontal stabilizer in a different location where it's not going to get hit directly by the prop wash as much, there's going to be less difference between applying power, taking it in or out, as far as what kind of pitching moment you get, since it's going to affect the trim tab less and affect the lift over the horizontal stabilizer less. So we've looked at a few different airplanes here, and hopefully what you guys are beginning to realize is that whether it's a high wing or a low wing airplane, it matters much more what shape the wing is and what sort of leading edge devices they put on there, a wing fence, things like that, really affect the way it flies far more than just the wing being 3 feet lower to the ground or 3 feet higher. Of course, the only thing that really changes when you move a wing high to low or low to high is the altitude that it's going to enter ground effect at. So you're going to enter ground effect slightly sooner in these low wing airplanes, but it really matters whether or not it's tapered or it's a Hershey bar wing, or if there's twist in the wing for a different angle of incidence, is going to really affect how it performs, how much aileron you need, whether it's a normal landing or a crosswind landing, and whether or not you're landing fast or landing slow, how much control authority you have, and how the airplane's going to respond to you. So ultimately, when you're transitioning from a high wing to a low wing airplane, or a low wing to a high wing airplane, it really doesn't matter. What matters more is that you're transitioning from one airplane to another, and just find a flight instructor to go up with you, explore those different characteristics. But before you get into the airplane, take a good look at it on the ground, really examine the shape of the wing that the designers have put in there, and then you can begin to make assumptions and expectations about how that airplane's going to perform, and you can talk to your CFI about those before you go up so you really have a better idea of what to expect from different airplanes when you're transitioning. Hopefully you found that helpful, guys. If you have any questions at all, leave them in the comments below. Make sure you give us a thumbs up on our video, like and subscribe to our channel to keep up with our latest videos. We release a new video every Monday and Thursday. Be sure to check out our Patreon page. We really appreciate y'all's support. It makes a big difference to us being able to keep producing these videos. Be sure to share our videos on Facebook with your friends. As always, if you can't fly every day, then fly at mikealpha.com. We'll see y'all next time.